Good morning.
Good morning.
So good to see all of you here today. I hope that you all had a wonderful Thanksgiving experience. Did you realize it was just a couple days ago, right? Seems like it's been a while, hasn't it? Yeah, well, it was wonderful. And a lot of folks are still visiting with family. And you know what they say about family and fish, right? You don't? Yeah, after 3 days, they all start to smell. So, time for the family to go home. Just a couple of announcements. One is that if you notice, the church has been decorated for Christmas. Yesterday, I came up in the morning, and the place was filled with people just doing projects here, there, and everywhere, decorating the tree and hanging banners and all. And the discussions about how it is done is always interesting because nobody can ever completely remember how we used to do it. And so some people have books, and they're like, here's a picture, and I don't like that, so we're going to do it differently, and it's great. But we want a little bit of a special thanks, a shout-out to Doug Oliveira for his work repainting the manger scene. After a while, that thing starts to get a little... The figures don't look like humans anymore, and so once in a while you paint them, and now they look like humans again. And
look at the cow, the bull cow
that's
sitting
there. A great job on the cow. It's important. Yes, sir. Mary, your wife modeled for Mary? You know, Mary was like 13, right? Okay. Not saying anything. I think it works perfectly. Oh, it's wonderful. And we have a Coco and Caroling event taking place in the parking lot on the 18th of December. Please plan to be here, which is going to be out in the parking lot over here singing carols. You can stay in your car and sing through the radio, or you can bring a lawn chair, which is really great, and sit out. We'll have hot chocolate and things to eat with that. The Christmas Eve service, of course, is going to be on when? Christmas Eve, which is a Saturday this year. And the plan is to have the service, just one service, but the time of it is being debated a little bit, and that's me. I'm asking folks, do we do it earlier so more people can participate, or do we do it later because then it's candlelight and it makes a difference? And it's starting to lean more and more towards doing it earlier so people that can't drive. But I'm willing to take anybody's advice and then ignore all of it. So please let me know what your thinking is for that. We'll make that decision this week. And then, of course, Christmas Day will be a service, but it's going to be different. It won't be in here. It'll be in the fellowship hall, and it'll be a breakfast service. We'll have worship and music and all the parts and everything, but it'll include breakfast, and it'll be over in the fellowship hall. Don't you think that sounds like fun? Yeah. Don't dress up. You know, come in your jammies if you want. if you got a new toy, you can bring it with you and play with it, you know. So... that's all the announcements that I have, but Susan has an announcement for us about something that this church does. It's very exciting and very helpful. Come on down.
Good morning. I won't even say most of you now. I'll say a lot of you have done this before, but we are blessed to have so many new members and new attenders that I wanted to make sure everybody knew. If I told you you could save money and bless everybody in this church, who wouldn't be for that, right? So it's our Christmas card exchange time starting next Sunday. Over in Fellowship, when you go in, look at the left table. We'll have gold boxes. In the gold boxes will be lots of file folders. If you would bring your cards, and I thought about this last night, I need to say bring your cards for people who are attenders, because last year we got cards for people who are shut-ins and people who live in other states, And they don't generally come pick up their cars. So if you're doing shut-ins and people who live in other states, please mail to them because they love getting cards. But anyway, bring your cards, find the person's name, drop it in the folder, and here's the hard part. You have to pick up your cards. And some people last year said, well, I didn't bring any cards, so I didn't check to see if I had any. Well, that's kind thinking, but even if you didn't bring any, you're probably going to get some. So check in your folder every time you're in the church, pick up your cards, because people are great and you get lots of them. You can come before church, after church, if you're in an activity at church, if you're a sewer, if you're a small group person, if you just come in and chat with Gail. When you're in the building, check over there and find your cards, drop off your cards, and we're starting on December 4th. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Are there any other announcements? Take a moment to fill out the pad on the inside aisle of the pew. Pass it to your neighbors, and you can learn the names of the folks that are sitting with you. And greet each other later in the service. All right, well, what? It's Nancy's birthday. Nancy who?
Randolph.
Nancy Randolph. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Nancy. Happy birthday to you.
And now let us turn our thoughts and our hearts over to God and begin our time of worship. are you downcast, O my soul? Why so disturbed within me?
Put your trust in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God.
We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield.
In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name.
Please stand. I know, you want to do that, don't you? It's a lot of fun. Let us now join together in a prayer of confession. Holy God, always you are near to those who seek you in faith. Having wandered far from the way, we confess we are weak in faith and trust. Centering our lives on our difficulties, we lose hope, and we fail to seek your guidance for tomorrow. Living not out of your forgiveness, We search for the perishable and trivial. We pray for your forgiveness, asking you to prepare us for a new coming of your Son into our church and our lives and our families. We pray that you, O God, would reveal your intentions to us so that we may walk in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Who is to condemn us? Jesus Christ, who came that all might be one to him, and by being one to him, being one to God. And so it is Jesus Christ who would condemn, and yet Jesus Christ died for us. Friends, hear the good news. Through Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Now take a moment and greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you. Thank you. Let's find our seats. Thank you. When I was out in seminary, we had to take a series of five examinations. One was biblical knowledge. You have to take that after your first year. And if you don't pass it, you don't pass. You don't go any further. And it's a tough, it's supposed to be a tough examination. One of the ways that I got through it, though, wasn't so much because I had been reading the Bible so much, but because I had been singing the Bible so much. Handel's Messiah was something I had performed since I was in high school over and over and over again. And the words in Handel's Messiah, of course, come from Scripture. And they are a lot of, there are a lot of prophetic readings in there. And so as I'm reading the test questions, I'm remembering, oh yeah, that's from His Yoke is Easy. Oh yeah, and that one's from The People Who Walk in Darkness, The Trumpet Shall Sound. And I remember all of those, and my other friends around me were struggling terribly because they didn't sing the Messiah, so just happened that way. And today's scripture is one of those passages that is very, very prominent in Handel's Messiah. It is a bit of scripture from the book of Isaiah. I wanted to sing it to you, but don't think I'm quite ready for that, but maybe next year. Here we go. The 9th chapter. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nations, increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning and for be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness. From that time on and forever, the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. The Lord has sent a message against Jacob. It will fall on Israel. All the people will know it, Ephraim and all the inhabitants of Samaria, who say with pride and arrogance of heart, the bricks have fallen down, but we will rebuild with dressed stone. The fig trees have been felled, but we will replace them with cedars. But the Lord has strengthened Rezin's foes against them and has spurred their enemies on. And then we turn to the Gospel of Matthew for signs of the end of the age, and we begin with the 36th verse. No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at a handmill, one will be taken and the other left. Therefore keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would have not had let his house be broken into. So you must also be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. This is the word of the Lord. Let's turn to God for a moment of silent prayer. Amen. It's been 50 years or so since C.S. Lewis wrote a wonderful series of books for children. Many of you, I think, have probably read them. You read them in your youth and read them to your children, and you've probably seen the movie. It's, of course, the story of the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, about these children who go into this fantastic land called Narnia. Now, I'm not going to tell you this story because, like I said, most of you know, but I found that there was a parallel in contemporary society for this same story in a way. Because the story is this wicked witch has cast a spell over the land, and the land is frozen. And it, the phrase in the book is, it is always winter, but never Christmas. Interesting phrase. There's actually, for musicians, I'm playing with an orchestra in St. Augustine, and we do a Christmas concert, and the number two song that we all hate to play, Frozen. Oh, boy. We're like, please, you know, let it go. Let it go. But the number one we hate? Frosty the Snowman. Oh, my gosh. We have to play that one more time. We all kind of, but anyway, that's a different story. But basically the same idea, where the world is frozen, and there is no joy, there is no hope, there's nothing positive coming from that. It's not until Aslan comes and breaks that chain, and, you know, I won't get into all the story. But I like this, because what we hear in Scripture today is a characterization of what the world was like before there was Jesus Christ. The characterization of the world, what did Scripture say? The people were walking in darkness, even great light. Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them the light would shine, the light of Jesus Christ. What does John record about the coming of Jesus? He says, in him was life, and life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. Now, in Narnia, it was always winter. In our world, people walked in darkness before Jesus came. They lived in an Alaskan winter all their lives. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, Isaiah says. They were standing on the edge of the dawning of a new and magnificent time. And it seems to me that the appropriate point at which to begin is to say that when the Messiah comes, when the Messiah came, light comes. An alternative to darkness, light. If you'll study the text of the morning, you'll see that when he came, God is clearly revealed. God came near in Jesus Christ. God, the unknowable, is now known. And we find that God is not judgment. We find that God is love and mercy. He's like the welcoming father who throws a party when the lost boy comes home. The lesson also tells us that when he came, we not only got a new vision of God, but we got a new view of who we are. Red and yellow, black and white, all precious in his sight, because we are all children of God. He's our Father. We are joint heirs of God because of Jesus Christ. He not only reveals who he was and more fully who we are, but Christ reveals and gives us a new view of what life and death are all about. The Apostle Paul says it best, "For me to live in Christ and to die is gain." One of the most comforting words in the Bible is whether we live or we die, we belong to Jesus Christ. His coming gives to us a new and longer view of life, not only for ourselves, but for all the ones that we love as well, who have gone before us. And we live here in preparation for what we're going to experience there, finally and fully and completely in the presence of God. What Guy Mark Pierce knew, when he knew he was about to die, he sent for a friend to ask him if he would conduct his funeral. And he said to him, "Let there be no mourning. I would have the service begin with the doxology and end with the hallelujah chorus. I am not going into the darkness, but into the light." Let that roll over you for just a few moments, the reality of what that really means. Because so much of death in our society is portrayed as going into the darkness, but it is not. Because a child was born, there is an alternative to your life and mine, to the darkness that's all about us. And that well-loved carol picks up the reality of his coming, saying, "Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings." Life and light to all he brings. Now, we'd be less than realistic if we didn't realize that while the light has come, we live in the context of a lot of darkness. We live in a time without being aware of the realities of the human depravity, random shootings, the abuse of children, violence, evidence of urban blight that dehumanizes the existence of so many. The church that I served in Columbia, South Carolina, was on a very busy street, kind of like a US 1, you know, type of thing. And right across the street, a company had purchased one of the buildings. And fortunately, the church is in a state capital. We had a lot of lawyers. I could say nothing. I'd be careful because I had a lot of lawyers. But that was good because we found out that they wanted to get a special liquor license. And in South Carolina, you can't have that within 500 feet of a church. It was within 500 feet. They would have to get our permission in order for that to happen. And you think, well, that's no big deal. We put our lawyers on it, and they all said to them, no, it's not going to happen. Because we found out it wasn't just a bar. It wasn't just, you know, liquor. It was a strip club right across the street from the church. And the funniest, and the reason why I bring this up and the funniest part of it was that the guy that bought it and was putting it all together called for a meeting with me and sat down in my office, and he said, is there anything that we can do that would get your church to let us do this? And then he dropped the kicker of, you know, monetarily, this could be good for you. You know what he's doing, right? Nobody ever bribes me, but, you know, it was like one try, and I'm like, you know, it really wasn't so much the feeling that I didn't believe that they should put a strip club across the street from the church. I just don't think they should put a strip club anywhere. And I told him that. He was not amused. We live in a world that is full of darkness of every kind. In David Brinkley's book, Everyone is Entitled to My Opinion, on the last page of that book, he writes, I have no, and this is a very interesting story. I have no idea what to say about this, so I will briefly give the facts. In Oklahoma State Prison, a man sentenced to death for murder was to be executed in a few hours. He said while he waited, he would like to take a nap, but that alone was bizarre enough, sleeping through the last hours of his life. But when the prison guards came to wake him up, he was out. He was unconscious. He had taken an overdose of something, apparently in a suicide attempt. They rushed him to the hospital, had him revived, brought him back to the prison, where they executed him. This is not 19th century Italian opera. It is 20th century truth. It is evidence of darkness among us. Jesus Christ was not born in a Norman Rockwell world. He was born in the midst of the worst possible atmosphere, in the context of the most depressing and despairing of times. In the face of a tyrant like Herod and a godlike person like Caesar and a symbol of Roman oppression like Quirinius. And look what happened. God brought light into the midst of the world, in the midst of the worst kind of human darkness, and God is still doing it. When Christ came, he offered you and me an alternative. But now what are we going to do with it? Well, now we must live in that light. Darkness deceives and it distorts our perspective. Whatever is worrying us seems to bear so heavily on us when it is dark. How many of you lay awake at night worried about something? Don't raise your hands, because the wind would blow me down from everybody doing it. You don't do it at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, do you? You do it when it's dark. Darkness obviously hides. We have an expression, under the cover of darkness, and someone has said that characters who are in the dark when no one else sees us. John in his gospel describes Christ saying, his life is the light that shines through the darkness. And so the lesson from Isaiah 9 describes and defines what happens when light comes. It will be a time when abundant blessings, like a harvest, a time of joy and celebration when the harvest is abundant. A text also says that the light, when it comes into our darkness, gives us freedom. The chains that bind us, the whips that scourge us, will be broken by the coming of Christ, the light of the world. Many of the chains that bind us, unfortunately, are self-inflicted. And the failure to forgive, the nursing of resentments, the holding of grudges, all of it increases the darkness about us and around us. And Christ wants us to be free of it all. So not only do we have an alternative to light, we are also not only challenged to live in that light, where our lives will be filled with abundant blessings like the harvest, when we'll be set free. The people who have walked in darkness have seen a great light. So my question is, have you? In December 1902, Lawrence Houseman, English author and artist, produced a nativity play in Bethlehem in the Great Hall of the University of London to enhance the beauty and the sacredness of the moment. He decided that rather than using a live child, he would use a light, beautiful, shining, very soft light. And that at the time when Jesus would be in the crib, they would have that light shining, and it was going to be really, really lovely. The light of the world would come. But then, you know, the old saying, the best laid plans of mice, you know, mice and men often go astray. I've always thought about that phrase, the best laid plans of mice. Do mice actually make plans? Are they down in my little hole there in my cellar, you know, making, no, I don't think so. Anyway, but the thing that happened is in the total darkness, as the light was to come on, it didn't. And somebody said, "What happened?" Another person said, "Hey, you switched off Jesus." Yeah, light didn't come on. It's a telling comment, though, to say it, isn't it? Many people switch off Jesus' light. The light has come, and they still want to dwell in the darkness. The good news has been shared, and they have turned a deaf ear to that good news. The people who have walked in darkness have seen a great light. Some have. Have you? Phillips Brooks wrote what I think is one of the most beautiful of the Christmas carols. Let me quote just a part of it. How silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his heaven. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in. And so the question this morning, at the beginning of this Advent season, is just as simple. Are you ready to let him in? Down where you live and where your decisions are made, are you really ready to let him in? So let's pray for that. Our Father, we are starting a new year, a new journey of faith. And we look first to see the hope that is ours. The hope of something very, very different from the darkness that we have experienced before. And so the world that is desperate for this hope is looking to us to be shining lights of that hope, to share that in the community and with others. Show us how to embrace that. And then to do that, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us give to God now our tithes and our offerings. Please be seated. I have some prayer requests that I would like to lift up to you. This one is for Lloyd Bush, who is suffering with pneumonia. So please keep him in your prayers. This is for David Gardner, who has colon cancer surgery on December the 2nd. Marilyn, give me, that's Friday, right? Yeah, okay. Dale Bennett, who is off the ventilator and breathing well. He's had his last blood exchange. He's over at the hospital right here in town. And his blood pressure and his heart are acting up some, so still not out of the woods. So please keep Dale Bennett in your prayers. Thank you. And this one's a little hard to read, so I tried. Kelly, where's Kelly Dawson? Kelly, I'll make sure I get this right, okay? Number one is Dorothy Ginger.
Teal.
T-E-E-L, okay. Your T's and your J's look a lot alike. It's okay. If you could see my handwriting, it's indecipherable. So Dorothy Ginger Teal and Barbara
Savino,
who's recovering from stroke and brain surgery.
Dorothy
is, okay. Oh, I see, okay, because you put a number one by it. And number two, for Barbara, is the treatment for breast cancer and beginning, is beginning, is that correct? Okay, I'm sorry I messed all that up, because those are very important. We certainly want to keep those. So Dorothy Teal and Barbara Salino, let's keep them in our prayers. Are there others? All right, let's turn our thoughts to God. Loving God, we come before you in this season of Advent, the season of expectations, the season of joy, the season of hope, the season of new beginnings and birthing. It is hard for us to be in a mood of quiet anticipation when all about us we hear Christmas music proclaiming that Jesus is born. It's hard to prepare our hearts to receive the gift of Emmanuel when the media and businesses are pulling out all the stops to boost their sales and profits. It's hard to hear that voice crying in the wilderness, a voice that calls us to repentance and to prepare the way of the Lord. It is hard to really examine our lives and discover those places where we need to turn around, to repent, and to take a new direction. Yes, it is hard. But we are here today gathered together in this place to open ourselves to yearnings we feel in our hearts, that this year Emmanuel will come to us in a new and unexpected way. We come in the spirit of hope that what has been foretold and promised by the prophets can actually happen in our own lives. Some of us need to hear John's challenge and make significant changes in our lives. Others of us are hurting and need to be gathered in as a shepherd gathers sheep. We need to be held in your arms. We need to feel safe and secure in your presence. We need to know that whatever our situation, difficulty, or sadness, we can trust in your knowing us by name, comforting us, and accepting us just as we are. And so we wait and we watch. Enable us to be caught up in the mystery, awe and wonder of this season of preparation. For we seek a place to call home where your light directs our journey and where our hearts find shelter. Allow us to be vulnerable enough to see in new ways the love that is born into the world in each and every moment. For you are a God of blessing and hope. Hear us now as we join our voices together in the great prayer that you gave us for moments just as this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand.
Once more, Charlie.
seated. Goes with you, and take some of that love that you have experienced today and share that with those on your pew. Now, once you leave this place, you're welcome to come over to the fellowship hall and enjoy some lunch over there together. Get to know each other a little bit better over there as well. But when you leave this place, know that you take the love of God with you into a world that only knows Jingle Bells and Frosty the Snowman and Frozen and... what's that one about the train, you know? Anyway, all of those things, which are, they're beautiful stories, but it's not the story of Jesus Christ. And remind them of that. Remind them always that the story is about love. It's about hope. It's about light. And that's something I think people need desperately. So do that and go in God's name. Receive now the benediction of our Lord Jesus Christ as he goes before you and follows after you and leads you along the way until at last we are all safely in his home. Amen.
Amen.